appreciate that. I know you've been a great supporter of the Dolphins through our cheer program. Jimmy Quadrozzi sings your praises, and I'm always watching from afar. So it was great spending a little bit of time with you yesterday, but also spent some time here today. So Jason Jenkins, one of the senior vice presidents here, oversee our communications and community affairs, so the work we do in the community in terms of our youth programs, our Football Unites program, the big football distribution we're having right now, along with our football and our off-field communications. I mean, obviously, we're a football team, and, you know, we work to win championships and have working hard on that end, but also, like, different events, whether it's Miami Open, you know, Rolling Loud, Jazz in the Gardens, all the different type of events we have in our stadium, but then also, like, our social media as well. So it's a full plate, but I'm blessed to have this position and being excited to work with an organization that really puts an emphasis on community relationships and community impact.
Awesome. Now, did you start with the Miami Dolphins, or did you come from different organizations?
So I grew up in the sports background. My father was at C.L. Williamson, was a professional football player, but used New Orleans. My mother, Mary Clay, is an educator, so sports and education was all of my background. I went to Texas Tech University out in Lubbock, Texas. I'm from Houston, Texas. Went to Texas Tech, and I was on the football team. So if anybody's live and Googling me, you won't be able to find any information on me. I never saw the field. It will say, like, you know, mile not found if you look for my football career. But I still had a passion, you know, for it. So working with the National Association of Black Journalists, working with the Black Student Association, I got a chance to make some contacts, meet some people. It really put me on the goal of being an athletic director. So from there at Texas Tech, I went to Lehigh University, spent an amazing time out there. I went back to Texas Southern in Houston, Texas. But I got an opportunity to work in San Francisco for the 49ers, and I was there for 8 years. And I got here to Miami in 2009. It's been an amazing ride ever since I've arrived in South Florida.
Awesome. And, you know, obviously you kind of told us a little bit of what your role entails, but I was hoping that you can, you know, maybe we can split a little bit and talk about one part of the role and then the other part of the role. But
sure.
If you kind of give us a little bit more specifics, you know, so maybe we start with the community affairs, because that's probably an easier one to kind of cover. But, you know, talk about the projects. You know, I know a little bit about the projects. As you said, I'm trying to be as involved as I can with the Dolphins, but there's a lot of people out there that don't know what you do in the community and the importance of the work that you do in the community. I was kind of hoping that you could kind of, you know, elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, we have a strong ownership, and the owner is Stephen Ross, the vice chairman, Tom Garfinkel, our head coach, Brian Flores, the general manager, Chris Greer. They all know that they are true stewards of the community. And so it's really about making an impact 365 days a year. So we have a program called Football Unites. It's an idea that when we win the game, score the winning touchdown, you look in the stands, doesn't matter your race, your gender, your sexual orientation, identity, ability, or faith, you know, people get connected in those moments. And obviously with South Florida being such a diverse place, is how can we connect all these diverse communities and promote humanity, you know, each and every day. So we work with a lot of organizations to amplify their programs, but also bring opportunities to bring them together. So we can come together for cultural tours around South Florida. We work on tailgates. We work on different events that we have that are designed to bring different groups who may have not have thought that they would be connected to another group, but with the idea of sports, they're all Dolphins fans. So we'll have LGBT groups working with, you know, women's organizations, African American groups, or you know, Hispanic, or, you know, Cuban, different areas as well. So it's cool to see using the Dolphins brand to connect people and unite people around the idea of humanity. That's a great thing. We also have the Dolphins Cancer Challenge. We have raised over $37.5 million for Sylvester Comprehensive Cancer Center. And so through a virtual rather than virtual race to really fight cancer. So, you know, health education and uniting people are our pillars. So we work with that, and our alumni base is strong in South Florida. We have a cheerleader that, you know, they do an amazing job of inspiring young women and being role models as well. So it's really a team effort led by our ownership and really pushed by our vice chairman and football leadership to really make a strong impact.
And, you know, I kind of wanted to kind of bring it down a little bit, because a lot of people that are following me, you know, obviously they're not NFL teams, or they're not at a professional level that an NFL team is. But I wanted you to kind of, you know, think of these teams in different countries and different communities, and, you know, tell them, why is this important? What is the importance of being connected with your community? Obviously, you know, you rely on the community because they're the ones that go to the game and they do
through sports, we have this amazing platform, and I think we have, no matter you know what the sport is, there's a fandom that's associated with the team. And we really want to be the team that they understand. You know, they're trying to win championships on the field, and they're working hard to do that. They care about it. They're working on that end. But they also care about what we care about from a community perspective. And so, like I said, South Florida is such a diverse place. But it's always cool to see you going through a Dolphins game or looking through social media, doing those things like all the different intersections that really make up South Florida. So whether it's a meal program where we're giving 1,000 meals each day coming out of Hard Rock Stadium for our community in Miami Gardens, you know, in need. On Sundays, we're working with local churches and local restaurants to be able to put money in the community. So making an impact each and every day. It's about a long-term impact. And, you know, there's also a part of growing your fan base, but there's also a part of being a steward, because we're a public trust. I mean, and I think what we have along comes with those expectations and responsibilities to be good members of the community. So we don't want to take, you know, for the community. We want to give to it. And like I said, that's the main thing that we're excited about our ownership group when we're able to do with it.
Yeah, and I, just from the little that I know of other cultures and other countries too, you know, we don't always have, and I can probably say this for most Brazilians, that the whole idea of giving back, right? It's much more of an American thing. And I can tell you that many times when I volunteer a lot of my time in football, and people always wonder why, you know, why you're giving back. And it's just part of me, right? It's part of my culture. So it's something I try to instill with people that don't have that vision to say, you know, the importance of giving back. If you give back, if you don't have enough, but you give yourself a little bit, you give your time, you give your, you know, what you know how to do, that comes back to you, right? In a much bigger scale, I think the professional teams have a platform that they can do that in a much bigger scale.
Yeah, it's all about your time, it's all about your treasure and your resources and knowledge that you have. And like for me on a personal level, while I didn't play professional football, you know, I played at the high school and collegiate level, and everything that I exist, you know, I owe myself to, you know, football and being able to be with the team, overcoming adversity, mental and physical toughness, working with other people. You know, I kind of grew up in a predominantly African-American area, and I really didn't interact with other types of people until really I got to college. But I think learning in college, learning with other groups, working with people, and being in huddles, being in different settings, you know what? We all have the same, you know, goals. And we also try to have the same goals and rights in life and equality in life as well. So that kind of like pushed me to try to have really like a passion for, you know, connections, a passion for learning, a passion for growth. And it's like this in the South Florida community, you know, it's amazing. You know, in terms of that, in terms of, you know, you go 15 different directions, a whole different culture, a whole different, you know, lifestyle, a whole different everything. So being something that is universally, you know, accepted around here, and but like always, what can we do to even push it further?
Yeah. I always joke that Miami, well, the Miami area is the capital of Latin America too.
That's right. It's definitely the gateway. You know, you look at our stadium and, you know, what we've done with international soccer and not Miami Open, potentially F1, like all these different international events. I mean, you're right about that.
Yeah,
you know, sure.
Yeah, I was surprised. I was talking about the Miami Open, and they were saying that last year, I think it was 20% of the population that came in were actually Brazilian.
All right. Yep.
Very, very surprised about the numbers up there. I mean, I understand that Brazilians come to Miami a lot, and it's been a bonus stage, but I didn't expect 20% of, you know, U.S. Miami Open to be Brazilian. So. And so, you know, we talked about the community. The final question I had about the, you know, the community was, so do you focus primarily on South Florida? That's, you know, you go as far as Fort Lauderdale sort of and west, or if there are other areas that, you know, we see that this program to come. And I only ask that because...
We got to get to you in Southwest Florida. What's going on, man? We got to work together. Let's talk offline and just try to figure out some ways we can make it up, because, you know, from this area, like, you know, from Palm Beach to Fort Lauderdale, you know, and you're going out to the Keys. I mean, we have been involved in areas, but let's get down to Southwest Florida. Let's do some work together.
Well, you know, this is what I was asking exactly because of that, because, I think there's
too many alligators, though. You got to watch out for the alligators, though. I mean, you have alligators in front of your house, right?
But it's, you know, and I got season tickets this year, and I'll be going to the games, right? And when you think about it, it's an hour and 15 minutes from Naples, where I live, from the stadium. And any major city that there's a football team, if you're trying to go to the stadium, it's an hour and a half at least, right? I lived in Boston for 20 years, and it was an No, you know, there's a few of mine that are on the organization too. You know, that's where we grew up there, but we're back here now. So.
I love it. I love it.
So let's switch a little bit and then talk about your role with the communications. You know, you kind of mentioned you gave a laundry list of things that you do on the communication side, but you know, kind of elaborate on that as well and the importance of that.
No, it is. I mean, having the ability to communicate, I think, and working with that has kind of helped me as I've grown as position. But I started in terms of the football. I grew up in football. I watched football, played football, loved football. And so having the opportunity to work with assistant coaches, players, to be able to help them with their media interviews, dealing with the media now with social media, et cetera, going on. So it, more so like day-to-day and working with a man like Brian Flores and Chris Greer, two amazing men of high character, high, intensity, and really, going to really change the culture of what we're doing right now is, working through that. So really day-to-day media operations, working with the Sun Sentinel, working with the Miami Herald, different affiliates, et cetera, along with the corporate communications. And again, like the great thing about Hard Rock Stadium, you kind of mentioned, it's a global entertainment destination. We're not just open, 12 Sundays during the year during the football season. You talk about Miami Open that's coming in. You talk about different events, Rolling Loud, Jazz in the Gardens, concerts, all the different things that we're doing. It's a lot of work kind of managing that and making sure people know about what's going on, working with the promoters, working with the organizers, and really trying to position Miami and South Florida as a global entertainment destination.
Yeah, and the importance of social media these days, because you kind of touch a little bit. Most people are getting their information from social media, so being there, it's key as well, right? And I know you guys from Hard Rock, the cheerleaders to the team itself. I follow all of them. You guys are always posting excellent content and keeping people informed of all the events that are happening, right? So.
No, it's definitely evolved, and I mean, media, they do a, they have a hard job, especially right now. They work through it. But like the way social media has become, you can really show your message and what you're doing and kind of show, unfiltered, as well. So there's been great opportunities, I think, to show, especially for community effort, because there's only so much time that you can dedicate to newscast or space, in a paper. But like social media is immediate. Social media is, you're able to show it. It kind of gives you behind the scenes aspect when you use it the right way. So that's been a great thing for us, really elevating mainly our community story has been really through social media. And connecting with people like who have great platforms, great fan base, and the people that work along with that. It's been amazing for us as well.
Awesome. I wanted to ask a question, and it's a question that I also discuss a lot with people. Sometimes they don't fully understand this, but the importance of the brand, right? And it kind of goes along with what we're talking with social media and all. The communications in itself, right? And the brand to the Miami Dolphins is something extremely valuable, extremely important. You don't want to damage that brand in any way by, saying something correctly or posting something incorrectly or something like that, right? And even getting involved with projects, right? If you're doing certain projects, you have to kind of filter what you're going to get yourself into or not because you want to protect the brand. And what is the process that goes into that? Because I can only imagine that, you're getting your table projects every single day of people that want to work and want to do this and all these different things, but you kind of have to filter through what you think it's going to benefit the brand and what's going to hurt the brand, and what is the thought process behind that?
Well, we have a great, creative and marketing team, and we're all connected. I think that's, to your point, it's not like the creative and marketing responsibility. It's an organization brand and how they present themselves and how they promote themselves and what they stand for. So it's more so like consistency across the board. As you can imagine, we get a lot of requests, throughout the day, a lot of requests, for things, and we have to do what's consistent with what the Miami Dolphins are about in terms of our mission. And we want to consistently compete for championships, win off the field, have a results-oriented culture with heart, and also be good in the community and really be stewards of the community. So we try to look at things, through that lens of working with our marketing team, working with our creative team, community relations, ticket sales, guest services, they're all part of those contacts, those things are all part, they're all part of the brand. So it's a lot of things going on, but we always have to look at that mission and have our high-minded purpose to kind of put them in the right direction.
I wanted to kind of not switch, but ask you a little bit of a different topic too. And it's something I was actually discussing one of my live Mexico, they've been expanding to different markets, trying to, you know, not only increase their fan base, but also, you know, obviously be able to recruit people from, be able to sell their products, and everything that entails between getting to a new market, right? And we discussed a little bit that we said, you know, that because of the diversity of Miami, and I think there's a lot of potential with Latin America, you know, and I speak for Brazil, obviously, but I think Latin America in general, is that something that perhaps is in the mind of the Miami Dolphins that, you know, to expand? Because I think your position in a location that, you know, if the Kansas City Chiefs try to do this, they wouldn't have the same market that you would have, right? So is that something that is discussed, that you guys talk about it?
Yeah, absolutely right. I mean, especially rewired. And it's something I didn't get, quite frankly, until I, you know, got here, you know, in terms of being in San Francisco, being in Texas, having never really you know, spend time in Florida and, like, work on the diversity. Absolutely. And I think the cool thing about the Dolphins is, even, you know, we have a great fan base here, but even on the road, we have amazing fans and an amazing, you know, legacy and history and brand that goes worldwide. But I'll never forget, like, I played a game in London, and it was crazy. I don't know if it's because of, obviously, Dan Marino, but I don't know how much it was East Ventura related or whatever, but, like, they all love the Dolphins, you know, when they came in. But especially being here, how you market, how you look at it, how you reach out to the fan base, it's a little different to me, because it's not just being in a different language. You know, it's being authentic to who you are and not being fake and being real to how you represent it. So it's something we look at as something that, frankly, we need to be better at, you know, as well. But I do think it's something that we understand and look at and how we communicate to all of our fans.
Yeah, I think overall, in most NFL teams are starting to realize that too, right, that the game is going beyond the U.S. border. If you look, for example, at the Patriots, not that I know much about the Patriots, but they have their website, they have it in Portuguese too, right? All the information comes out in Portuguese, where they have everything. So the public in Brazil, they have a handle in Portuguese, they have all the information in Portuguese, which then, obviously, you know, there's a lot of people in Brazil that don't speak English, they can still get information about it. Same thing with Spanish, they have it in Spanish, they have it in Dutch, so they have different things. But to your point, I mean, it is more of the language. They're not necessarily doing events in Brazil, they're not inviting Brazilians to go to their games, or, you know, and it's obviously much harder in New England than it is than it would be here in Miami. But I think most teams are starting to realize that, you know, like, the game is growing internationally. Obviously, with these international games that we have, that you know, there's opportunity to kind of bring more people in to your fan base too, right? And which obviously then comes with multiple things with it, right? More sales, more revenue, but it's not only about that, you know, having more of a fan base as well.
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at what the game, NFL's super international aspect, you know, look at Durval, who I know, you follow and, you know, spend some time with him. It's a big deal for us. Absolutely.
Awesome. Wanted to ask you now a little bit of, about COVID-19, right? So obviously, you know, it has affected everyone. Everyone that I talk to, from business owners to regular, you know, workers, they say, you know, obviously, it was a time that it allowed us to kind of sit at home, reinvent ourselves a little bit, or at least analyze what we were doing and how we're doing things differently. And then, you know, when we're ready to come back, we'll come back with different mindset and different processes, and different ways of doing things. Is that something that it happened to you guys at the Miami Dolphins as well?
No, for sure. I mean, like everyone else, you know, for us, it was a horrible situation, for sure, and still happening in our situation. But from a time perspective, it hasn't, to this point, impacted the season, looking at those things. So we were able to look at strategies and ways to make an impact in the community, but also reevaluate everything that we're looking at doing and what a stadium can do. So from a community aspect, we felt the immediate need was around youth and elderly, around food insecurity. So we worked with Dade and Broward County school systems, gave them a significant amount of money to be able to extend some of their food and meal programs, work with some pastors and church leaders and faith leaders around the Miami Gardens area, and also work with people in South Florida. Our alumni, they have restaurants. We work with them to work and give you know, food to our Football Unites partners for a significant amount of time. And then now, the meal program, where we kind of talked about before, a year-long commitment, because it's not only the food insecurity that we're helping in our area, but also jobs. We had a lot of people, especially workers that were around the stadium, that kind of lost some jobs and revenue opportunities because of Miami Open being not happening, because all the events we have not happening. So now we're employing them for a year, and they know steady income is coming to be able to support these programs. We the center plate our provider, they're making those meals for a year, and it's a consistent way to kind of get them back on their feet and working with the restaurants as well. So from the community aspect, we're focusing on job insecurity, food insecurity, loss of jobs, and also trying to get money back to the community from local restaurants. But from a creative, innovative side, our Vice Chairman CEO, Tom Garfinkel, has been amazing in terms of how he reimagined it. So you see recently, we're putting like a drive-in theater, you know, within the deal. So just being innovative, that's how can we keep people safe, but also what can we do to kind of give people that release and entertainment value. So we've announced that we'll be having a couple of events, upcoming, pretty soon, along with making sure people feel comfortable if and when, well, when we'll be able to get back in the stadium. So we work with the Global Biorisk Advisory Council to create their certification. It was important to get a third-party certification, not going through us. And, yeah, we cleaned it, so we're good. How can we get better and make sure it's in that area? So we have a GBAC star rating that we're looking to attain. We would be the first venue, to have that. But it's giving people that peace of mind to understand when they come back into the stadium, it's being looked at clean and being tested in a way that's top-notch. Not even to our standards, which go very high, but standards that are being done by the people that are the best in the business.
And Hard Rock, I mean, it's a place that I go often now, obviously, because I live here. I visit a couple other stadiums around the U.S. And I have to say that every time I go there, I have such a good experience with the people are serving, people helping are super nice. The stadium itself is, I never had really a bad experience there. I think
That's
the
right.
stadium is one of the most beautiful stadiums there are too. Very modern looking. And then there's a lot of little pieces to it, right? A lot of art to it, right? I think in one of my last tours, I learned that it's, because I've done, I think, about five or six of those tours that I bring out with other people, but I think I've learned that it can be considered a museum, right? Because it has so much art on it, it would be one of the biggest museums in the world, if I'm not mistaken.
Absolutely. It's one of the world's largest collection of street art. We worked with our Golden Global Arts and Jessica Goldman, whose family and her like Wynwood, different areas throughout New York and throughout the country. So it's pretty much a gallery. Like you see like different things that are going on. Like we have Shula like art. We have world class art that's being going around. And so South Florida, Miami, what do you think of? Entertainment, art, culture, history. We try to encapsulate that within the venue. And then like you said, I think the Super Bowl for a lot of people was a big deal to kind of really showcase what it was, and it was a great event, a great halftime, entertainment, great game. But I think it was really showing the global level. And another thing that Tom Garfinkel did is intuitively you would think that you would, when you do a renovation, you think you would raise seats. He actually took down the seats and created more intimate environments throughout the stadium. So it's almost like when people think of just like a stadium, they go, okay, well, you have a suite, maybe you have some regular seats and then cheap seats. I mean, every area tells a story within the stadium, different levels, and I think it's been a great revenue generator, but it's been a thing that people will want to see, and especially coming from where it has been. It's been an amazing transformation.
Yeah, and they took some of the seats down to get it closer to the field, right?
Correct. Yeah, they're sideline, almost like courtside luxury seats.
Yeah, those are nice.
You drive and see, you're a big ball, I see where you are. So you drive through the lane, have living room box seating, and it's almost like you're in your living room. We have 9 open air suites called appropriately the 9. That's unlike anything. It's like you're in the back of a yacht or something. Well, you probably, since you've been in the living room, you probably know what they're like, feeling back of yachts and going around, doing that. And then and even some of the seats that people could be considered like the cheaper or small options, they're underneath the shade canopy, which is really one of the coolest, best places to be up there. So hats off to the innovation and creativity of Stephen Ross and Tom Garfinkel to be able to create these different options. I like when you had Super Bowl, when you have events, and also Dolphins games. It's a place, it's unlike no other, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. Wanted to ask you real quick, what are your thoughts about the season this year? I had to ask that, obviously.
Oh, for sure. Hey, I mean, you asking it, my wife asking it, my mom asking it, my 3 kids asking it. And so, the reality is there's been nothing that's been told us that it would be otherwise not, be on time to go. There's no off-season program physically right now. Players are doing things virtually and having to do workouts, on their own and do those different things. But, it's going to be really will defer to the NFL, and they'll tell us when it's you know, safe. And that's why we're trying to practice and do anything like the drive-in theaters, like, you know, like the G-Back Star Rating, just to make sure that when people, you know, come in and come back, they know they have a safe and healthy environment. But, you know, we'll defer to the NFL, because I know they're, you know, working just to make sure it's the best situation for everybody.
Awesome. Let me just see, because I got a couple questions here, and I want to make sure that I answer the questions. Someone is just saying, I'm staying up past midnight in Ireland for this.
Oh, wow.
Jason, what's the biggest challenge in your role that you would say?
Well,
this is Joe from Ireland.
That's a great question. Thanks, Joe. I mean, really, it's what we're on right now, like social media. You know, I mean, it's like when we tell our players all the time and the people that own it, you know, the great thing about social media, you can get your message out directly to the public, to your fans, to people, but it's also the best thing. It's also the challenging thing in the same way. So using judgment on social media, making sure you're putting, you know, you're representing yourself, the organization in the best way. And also kind of like dealing through this COVID-19. You know, it's been a horrible situation in terms of, you know, what's going on. And also now with civil unrest, but I think, you know, through that, we have opportunities to make ourselves better, to try to help change, you know, what's going on and help impact our community. Because South Florida, I mean, whatever it's hurricanes, other situations, we've always, you know, stepped up. And we've always tried to be an impact. And continuing in this situation, how can we make the biggest impact? And how can we inspire other people? But also, how can we help support people that really need it during these times?
I was going to kind of do a follow-up to that question. You know, obviously, you know, when you have players, you have coaches, you know, they're on social media, so on their social medias, and you don't have control over that, right? Like, they can post whatever they want, they can say whatever they want. Is there any kind of coaching or some kind of, you know, do they have to take a course from the communications, the things that they shouldn't post, or they shouldn't, you know, how they should behave on social media?
Yeah, I mean, we talk about media training all the time, and it's really the idea that you're always basically doing media interviews every time you're on this situation. So sort of my only thing was like, it's like three things. Does it need to be said? Does it need to be said right now? Does it need to be said by me? And if you feel comfortable asking those three questions, by all means, you know, go at it. But just kind of look at those things where you don't want, you know, underneath that lens, because there's an opinion on everything, you know, to have, and just using your judgment in terms of how, you know, how to do it. There's been a lot of opportunities that has been used to great end. And I think, you know, if we continue looking at it that way with that lens, I think it can be a good situation.
Yeah, I mean, I think each player, just like the team, has, as you mentioned, like a platform to do good. And, you know, it's a platform that not a lot of people have a chance for. Because, you know, you say one thing and there's 100 people, you know, saying what you're, reading what you're saying, right? You're back? Mm-hmm. You're there?
I'm sorry. I had some user error for a second. I mean, you know, like last time you said something, I was all upside down, so I kind of got lost for a second. Can you repeat that, please?
Yeah, I was just saying, you know, just like the team, you said that it, you know, has a platform to use to put good through the community, you know, with social media, through good community players have too. It's just a matter of how you use it, right? Because
absolutely.
Once you say something, you have 1,000 people, 1,500 people, you know, reading you, and they're all going to perceive things in a different way, so you have to be very careful. Very clear what your message is, so you're not perceived in a different way, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, sometimes there's like not a lot of nuance, you know, to it. So you have to kind of be clear in your direction, clear on what you're trying to accomplish, and understand, you know, what you say, you know, has you're accountable to what you say, accountable to what your actions, accountable to what you show. Like we're not going to be parents of these guys. These are grown men, grown women, but they all do represent the brand. They all do represent, you know, the Dolphins, and we have to look at it. You know, through that lens. They represent themselves first, but it's also, you know, your name is Miami Dolphins, .. You have to understand the accountability and responsibility that comes with that.
Perfect, awesome. Well, Jason, we're coming into about a half hour, which is what I had promised I would keep you here, but I wanted to see if you had a message for all the people that are watching all over the world, like Joe here. I'm sure there's a lot of people in Brazil, a lot of people in Europe, and, you know, want to see you had a message watching.
No, I mean, we hope if you're not Dolphins fans, you kind of become Dolphins fans in some kind of way. See, you know, continue to follow Felipe. Look at what we do in the community. Look at what we do on the field. I mean, we're a team that's going to work hard. We're a team that's going to do great work in the community. And we just appreciate opportunities and platforms like this to be able to tell, you know, our story, and hopefully that we can, you know, make meaningful connections going.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate your time. I'm going to take